as soon as we get our guests, you put them right through, and we'll begin. I just didn't want to sit there and put you all on hold. It's the Man Cow. How are you? And I'm here, and we are live, and it's Monday Night Live, Man Cow Monday Night Live. I have so much to talk about, and I don't know where we're at technically. Just all kinds of stupid issues, man. We're doing this just shoestring. This is just for fun. Mickey Mouse operation, you know, but no pedophiles, unlike other Mickey Mouse operations. If you teabag with somebody who has a nut allergy, could that be considered an attempted murder? I wonder. I ask you. All right. There we go. Can you hear me? I'm told that when I'm not on the mic, it sounds horrible. Of course, when I'm not on any mic, it sounds horrible. Listen to every radio station that doesn't have me, and it sounds horrible. I'm just watching this government just, and I don't know if you saw in France that if you insult certain medical procedures, you can get 3 years in jail now. And it's part of this horrible vision I've been having, which has kept me up. And there's a difference between a dream and a vision. And I don't know if I'm going to talk about this vision this evening or not, but we're waiting on our guest. We're trying to get to our guest. I wanted to say, I looked at the 100 top movies of last year getting ready for the Oscars, and I go to the movies a lot, and I'm really into the movies, and I knew 5 or 10 of them. And Hollywood is crashing and burning, and while they stick with agenda, and that's what it all is, right? Everything redone so that it's not, well, it doesn't include people like me, and I imagine many of you. I read an article today from Sony about Sony and about the new Spider-Man related movie called Madam Web. It's the worst. Hey, did you see it? You didn't see it? Oh, everybody says it's horrible. Yeah. Anyway, and they admit that 70% of their audience is men. And yet you may have seen the new woman that's doing Star Wars, but it's a woman, so it's going to be fantastic. And she said, no, I like making men uncomfortable. I like making men unhappy, something to that extent. And I continued to watch Marvel, which I loved. I loved the comic books when I was a kid. And I continue to watch these people wring their hands and act baffled at what's going on. You had Robert Downey Jr. with the biggest movies of the year as Iron Man. You had all of, you know, you had a great Captain America. You could have done these movies for the next 10, 20 years. And really for the next 50 years, because they can digitize everybody. Look at what they did with Harrison Ford in the last pretty good Indiana Jones movie. But remember, that Indiana Jones movie had him dying and the woman putting on his hat and the music kicks in. They were going to kill off Indiana Jones and people went batshit crazy and they changed it. They did a pretty good job. So 70% of your superhero movies your audience is men. And they just do everything they can to shit on men. And if you say anything about it, if you don't like how they've taken Iron Man in the comic books, and last I saw was a 15-year-old African-American girl. And again, I have no problem with 15-year-old African-American girls doing whatever a 15-year-old African girl would do or not do, or she can be a superhero. I don't care. But Tony Stark was the rich industrialist, drinker, womanizer, billionaire, Elon Musk kind of guy. And so when we just continually see everything that we loved, create new characters, but don't destroy the ones we love. So they want to fix it. They want to make money again. Put Robert Downey Jr. There you go. Put Robert Downey Jr. back in the Iron Man suit and have some women that guys want to look at. Let's be honest. What was the other one? The Marvels, Miss Marvel or something? All of these out of shape women. Oh, go girl, girl power. All this bullshit. Look at the women that are in Madam Web. I'm sorry. Scarlett Johansson. Was she attractive? Not to me, but she looked pretty good in the Lycra. Okay. Get some women that look good in the Lycra. Let's do this right. And you can save your superhero movies overnight. I'm sorry. They're superhuman. They're not supposed to look like me and you. They're not supposed to look like the tubby people that you sit on the bus with. I'm a superhero. No, you're not. And I invite you to look at the women of men. Oh, they're beautiful. My wife would do it, and your wife will do it. If your wife's listening right now, or you're a woman listening right now, Adele is beautiful. I mean, I just have to buy into all this bullshit all the time. Oh yeah, she's beautiful. Yeah, yeah. They got Angelina Jolie when she was what, 60 to finally do a movie? And Nicole Kidman, who I don't think there's an original part of her left. She's in the Aquaman movie. That was a flop. And this Bob Marley movie, and I have spent several moments of my life with Bob Marley's widow. I really liked her. And his family, really like them. They played my show. The Wailers played my show. And I like Ziggy. And this movie is complete made-up shit. And, why don't they show political Bob Marley? Why don't they show all the hoes he had, all the girlfriends he had, he was a man-whore. Why don't they talk about all the illegitimate kids? Why don't they? Well, because his wife did the movie. I would like to think when my wife does the Mancow movie, it will be Saint Mancow. I get it. I get it. So how are we doing on our guest? Are we going to have our guest on or not?
Because I can just keep... Oh, there he is.
I know, buddy. I'm working on the other one. It's almost pulled up.
Okay, we'll take him off for a minute. And we'll come back to him. You know, I want to say that I was at the House of Blues, and I had a woman come up to me, and she was gunning for me. And people treat you the way they feel about you. And I want to say that again. People treat you the way they feel about you. And I'm a guy that loves nostalgia. You just heard me talking, waxing poetic about Tony Stark and Iron Man and those great Golden Age comic books. And you can see behind me stuff that I'm nostalgic for. You got Jesus over here. That's not nostalgic, but maybe you can see the incredible signed Malcolm McDowell bust from Clockwork Orange. Above me, you can see Shatner's head, the Mego doll. Can you see Johnny West, Best of the West series? You couldn't do that now. Garamond from Ultraman. And I'm a nostalgic guy, and it's just stupid because everything you care about has been digitized and regurgitated and rewritten just to piss you off, it seems like. So people treat you the way they feel about you. Marvel and Disney treat you the way they feel about you, and they don't give a shit. Is it obvious I don't care about the audience? Is it obvious Kathleen Kennedy does not give two shits about the male audience? Can you not see it? Can you not feel it? Can you not hear how they talk to you? So the answer is you don't support them. Madison, my anniversary. Madison, Wisconsin, my anniversary. Valentine's Day. I called five times. Called five times. A sushi place called Red. No, you're in the bar. Sorry. Sorry. You know that big sickening smile? Sorry. That condescending, they care, but boy, they'd love to put you on the boxcar look, right? Yeah, oh, you don't have that? Oh, yeah, no, you can't come in. Sorry. I don't want to sit at the bar with my wife on Valentine's Day on our anniversary. That's why I called you five times. Yeah, sorry. And then the glasses were filthy, and I made a call. I thought, you know what? I'm Mancow. And it's my money. I don't have to give it to these tricksters. So vote with your time, vote with your money. And if people aren't treating you the way you want to be treated, if you're not celebrated, if you're tolerated, the walk away. Something I found out, I remember with my friend Matt, who I reunited him with his father, but there were dozens of people you may remember, and I reunited them. And I want to tell you how many times it was great. Never, never. It was never great. If you haven't talked to somebody for years and you have this idea, God, I'd love to see them again. They don't want to see you. They don't want to hear from you. They don't want to talk to you because guess what? In 2024, if you want to talk to somebody, you can talk to them. If somebody cared about you or they gave a shit about you, there's Facebook, there's Instagram, everything. I mean, I called a buddy of mine, Tristan. Yeah, I'm sure I did something some drunken night. I pissed him off or something. I don't know. Hit on his girlfriend or something. I don't know. And I got you. How are you, buddy?
Fine.
Oh, shit, I must have done something. I remember walking into a bar with Chris Farley. Wait till they see me. They love me. And he walked in. Everybody in the bar goes, get out of here, you bastard, after what you did. Oh, shit. I mean, it was very funny. Oh, shit, get out of here. And he didn't remember what he had done. So I'm sure I've done things I don't remember. So I walked into the House of Blues, and this woman came over gunning for me. And like a fish, I rose to the bait. And I had had a couple of sips of rum, Diplomatico rum, my favorite. And I was feeling good. I was happy. I was surrounded by people I love. And this woman tore into me. And I told her what she could do. I told her what she could do and where she could, you know. And of course, it became. Well, what do you think it became? I was just saying hi to him. I just I went, you know, a woman. It was just, I went over and he went crazy. He went crazy and cursed me. My wife's standing there. My friends are standing there. Everybody saw it, but that's the story she's telling people. Okay, I'm not ready for Ted now. He's going to have to wait. But, you know, guys, going back to 5 years old, and it's been a few years. I'm going to be 27 this summer. But it was cute at five. It was cute at 10. And I don't think there's anything cute about me at this point. I don't think there's anything sweet. I don't think there's anything that I don't just beat my brains in over every day. And I don't know if it's all the chemicals. Have people changed or is it me? I don't treat people like that. I don't attack. I really don't. Yes, I'm here doing a show, but in real life, I'm nice to everybody. I have a smile for everyone I greet. I react. I don't attack people. I just don't. And I really think it's been since the plague. Do you feel people are different? Am I alone? I'm honest to God. I really don't know. I've had other people tell me, God, just. So not figuring out the cruelty, not figuring out the inhumanity, not figuring out why a Brandon Johnson would bring up race when people are being killed. Why the mayor of Kansas City is offended that the killers were called thugs. Well, that's racist. Wait, what? Wait, we're more concerned that these killers were called thug? Patriot is a racist word. I've talked about it. I still don't get that one. Or is it all by design? Is it just gaslighting? Are they just trying to make us freaking crazy? None of it makes any sense. I knew Mike Wallace. Mike Wallace knew me. We were on friendly terms. We were not friends. But Mike Wallace knew me. He knew me by name. I ran into him several times. Man Cow. Oprah knew me by name. Man Cow. That always shocked me. Van Morrison, the singer, Man Cow. That shocked me. John Fogerty, Man Cow. They weren't presented with me. I wasn't introduced to them. They knew me. They knew who, and it freaked me out. I like, wow, that guy, Dan Rather knows, not Dan Rather, Mike Wallace knows who I am. My lunch, there was some charity dinner some charity lunch, and my wife ended up having a lunch with Mike Wallace from 60 Minutes, you remember, and she loved it. Anyway, I'm watching this documentary about Mike Wallace, very nice documentary, and he suffered from depression, and they were cheering him on because he met with Putin. He interviewed Putin. Wow. And I mean, do you remember him meeting Khomeini? His words, not mine. Remember, he was afraid of being killed, Mike Wallace, so he said what other people said about Khomeini and Iran. Remember during the hostages? What does he call them? Your holiness or whatever. Yeah, holy, sure. Not my words, but people say you're a crazy son of a bitch. Not me. Do you remember how afraid Mike Wallace was of Ayatollah Khomeini? But celebrated. That's what I brought. I got brought up in this. Working at WLS, working at news stations, working at Fox News Channel. My God, you get the big interview. And now Tucker gets Putin. And he's not a hero. He's a traitor. Time Magazine gave Hitler Man of the Year. We can't talk now. And to me, in this opera box, I was there with Ryan Cheverini. You know him? Great kid. And someone came after me and I fought back. I'm not proud of myself. From this neighborhood, I remember Phil Donahue. I mean, good night, Irene. Phil Donahue. And he was on with O'Reilly and everybody called, oh, did you see O'Reilly? No, O'Reilly, I'm sorry. When you lose your cool, you lose. And I've lost a lot. Wait, what did you say? You just lost. The person that smiles and, okay. I see an injustice and I have to speak up. So Tucker is a bad guy because he spoke with Putin? Do you think we're getting the full story of what's going on over there? Do you think we're getting the full story of what's going on our border? Anyway, like I said, going back to 5 years old, I couldn't understand people. I still don't understand thievery and cruelty. And yes, I make jokes. They're jokes. And maybe by today's standards, they're cruel and harsh. But I was brought up hanging out with it. I helped write an Andrew Dice Clay record. gave him some ideas for an album, not one of his best. He thanks me in his book. I knew Sam Kennison. I knew these people, man. We could take a joke. We could rib each other. So I may not be your cup of tea, steaming hot, strong. You know, I get it. Maybe just one little sip. But this woman came in gunning for me. Oh, there's Mancow. I'm going to get him. I am going to get him. And I reacted. And I lost. Do you feel like people are different? Yeah, it's not just me. We got a small studio audience here. People are agreeing with me, you know, that they feel, I don't know. And I really feel like we're getting set up for another, what are they calling it, Disease X? In all these interviews where a giggling Bill Gates talks about the new plague. That, oh, it's coming. It's coming. And it feels like it's coming just in time for Election Day. Just in time to vote. Well, you can't go vote. You better do that from home. All 500 people in your apartment. Remember, you are the carbon they want to reduce. Remember that. Julian Assange says, and we've seen it, haven't we? We've seen it with all of the rhinos. We've seen it with the Hillarys. We've seen it with the Bushes. War without end, amen. And it doesn't matter if we win, just war, 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 constant war, except under Trump. Do you remember how it was going to be the end of the war? End of the world, excuse me, misspoke. End of the world. You never acknowledge this when you misspeak. You just keep going. It makes it worse. I just made it worse, but whatever. And you never apologize for crying. Don't ever apologize. We were at my father-in-law's funeral, the great Frank, and some people were crying, and nobody said they were sorry. I hate that. Oh, God, I'm sorry. Your dad died. Cry. You're supposed to. Julian Assange said he's seen the paperwork, and it's endless war. That's what they have planned for us. Sure seems out right, except for Trump. Hillary, all of them, man, all those hippie liberals, boy, they just love killing, man. They just love it. But don't call the shooters in Kansas City the chief shooters. Boy, they went away quick, didn't they? And the pro-Palestinian trans shooter at Joel Osteen's church who brought a child as a shield or some such nonsense. Boy, that went away quick, didn't it? The shooters in Kansas City, boy, that just disappeared at a chief celebration. Isn't that something? Imagine if they had been Trump supporters. Imagine if they had taken a shoestring, and put it around Juicy Smollett's neck. Imagine what a story that would be. Yeah. Yeah. And a different national anthem. Did you catch that? Did you know that? Oh, yeah, they did the black national anthem at the Chiefs game, at the Super Bowl. At the big game, excuse me. I won't say the other word, the big game. All right, let's. I didn't want to do any of that, but I want to go to Dr. Ted now. Doc, bring him on. Do we have a beat? Doc?
Hey, man, Cal, you look great.
Thank you. So, this is how you and I talk. You and I do this hours every week. Exactly what you just heard. Are you sick of hearing me rant?
No, I love to hear you rant. You're telling the truth, and the truth will set you free, the Bible says. And I like it when people tell the truth. The problem is, light has come into the world, but the world has preferred the darkness, the Bible says. And so people don't want to hear the truth. They want to hear the truth about what the political people are doing in Washington and how both sides of the aisle are being controlled by the same individuals who run the international banking cartels. They don't want to talk about any of that stuff. All they want to talk about basically is, you know, pro this or pro that or Biden this or Trump that. Yeah. The reality is that, you know, you told me a long time ago, man, Cal, you said, if you really want to get big in radio, you got to be partisan. You got to be right. You got to be left. You can't go down the middle. You can't. And ask those questions. Otherwise, you make people think too much. Like George Carlin said, they don't want an educated group of, you know, people that can think in the United States. They want them just smart enough to run the machines, but stupid enough not to stand against the New World Order and the things that they're doing to us and all the crap they're putting to us all the time. It's insane what they're doing to us.
Ted Brower is healthmasters.com. He also has a successful podcast with his son, Austin. And we really do need to get rid of Austin and get me on there on a daily basis. I'm far more talented.
Let's do it, man, Cal. Let's do it. Let's do it.
I kid. Listen, Ted. Ted was great on my show. We talked a lot about cancers and sicknesses and all kinds of things. My father-in-law, I just lost him to the turbo cancer and the new turbo cancers and kids passing out on the field. And there's a mystery. I don't know why this just started a couple of years ago. And I don't want to get into it, Ted, because I don't want to get kicked off. And you know what I'm talking about. But you know exactly what's going on. And so do I. And it's called eugenics. And the herd is being thinned. And we're the herd, by the way, folks. And yeah, Ted, I did say that to you. Dr. Ted, I did say that to you. Yes. If I wanted to be right wing, Bush, I could have, man, I would be everywhere and I'd be making a lot more money. If you want to do the party line, and same thing to the left, Biden, 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 no matter what he does. If you want to kiss that ass, you're going to make millions more. And see, I never liked big government. I didn't like Obama's big government, and I didn't like certain people. I don't want to mention their names because I don't lose friendships, but certain big name talent that, you know, they were all upset over Obama. But when Bush did the same thing, it's okay. But you don't like Trump. This bothers me. I still don't understand it.
I don't like any of them, Mad Cow. Yeah, to me, well, the way I look at it is this.
Yeah.
The world, okay, let me go here with this. The world has been run for thousands of years by the ancient Canaanite religions, period. It's what they've done. And that's why we have all this child trafficking. That's why we have all this abortion, all the rest of the stuff, because it's part of their religion and practices. We have to understand that they're the ones that control the international money cartels. They're the ones that control the cult, as David Icke likes to call them. And they're the ones that run both sides of the thing. And Dr. Otto Kahn, he's one of the founding members of the Federal Reserve Bank. In an interview he did about 100 years ago, he said that the international Kabbalists, you know, this would be the Luciferian synagogue of Satan that we talk about, this is the group that controls both sides of the houses. They control the Senate. They control the House. They control the Republicans. Yeah. They control the Democrats. They control everything. And it's all through the money strings and what they do. And they're the ones that run the planet. And so when we get partisan and we say it's all Donald Trump or it's all Joe Biden, it's not.
Yeah.
You got to look at we don't have a three-wing circus. We've got like a 10-ring circus. But the three main center rings right now are Biden, Trump, and Putin. And they're keeping us all distracted while they strip the assets out of the United States, while they drug us down with drugs like fluoride and tricyclic antidepressants and Prozac and Zoloft and all the rest. Now there's a big shortage of Ritalin and Adderall because one of the major manufacturers has shut down, which has pushed people to the street. And people don't realize that Ritalin and Adderall are Schedule II drugs in the same category with morphine, opium, and Percodan. They're heavily controlled substances. I mean,
why do they want everybody on Adderall, doctor? Why do they want everybody on Adderall?
Well, because Adderall is a sustained release, amphetamine. And what it does, it keeps people hyped up. It keeps them happy. It basically fills that God-shaped vacuum on the inside that only God can fill.
I want that.
Well, you can do that with the Holy Spirit. But you don't need Adderall.
This semi-glutide, a miracle drug?
Semi-glutide, I'm not familiar with that one at Macau.
It's a weight loss thing. It's this Ozempic.
Ozempic, yeah. No, what that is, that basically is that stabilizes insulin level. We have a product that's called benfotamine. It's an advanced form of that. It does the exact same thing for $30 or $40 for the bottle. It does a great job of stabilizing insulin. What they're talking about is syndrome X with the Ozempic. And what that does is that stops the body's release of insulin. And so when you don't have insulin, it's a storage hormone, you start burning body fat. The problem with it is as soon as you get off of it, you gain the weight back because most people don't change their body. Their dietary habits. The benfotamine will do the same thing, but it doesn't cause all the side effects.
Okay, Ted, you're going to have to give one. I want you to give one word answers. In fact, I don't even want you to answer anymore. I want you just to nod.
Okay.
I'm messing with you. I'm messing with you. Poor Nathan. Last week, I messed with him. Ted, I want to be a real. I want to be a real jerk. I went to Hamels. Do you remember Himmels?
Himmels.
You and I went where we had the schnitzel.
Oh, yeah, the German restaurant. I loved it.
And the sisters were there, and I thought about your wife, and my wife thought about your wife, and we cried, and I loved her. Anyway, wonderful girl.
I loved her too. My wife died a couple years ago. My wife died a couple years ago.
So we were all good friends. Anyway, you have been dating. Probably a bad transition, but I do want to get to this. And I want to say
that's a terrible transition with Van Cal.
Well, it's been years. It's been years.
It's been a couple of years, yeah.
I want to separate from you, Ted. I was in Costa Rica 10, 15 years ago with some very successful businessmen, and I knew some of their wives, and they were sleeping with women in their early 20s. And to this day, when I go out, I have young women hit on me because I think the chemicals are making these men eunuchs. My wife, I'm shocked by a 25 or 30 year old woman hitting on me. And folks, stay with me. Ted, stay with me. And these men 15 years ago, they said, look, man, Cal, I love my wife. I don't want to cheat on my wife. But she went through the change of life and now she won't have sex. And you just, okay. I went out for a second. Anyway, it just really hit me. What would I do? I love my wife. You know my wife. I madly love my wife. But what would happen if she goes through the change of life and suddenly, I don't have sex anymore. My friend Chris, his beautiful wife, man, don't want to have sex. Well, what about me? Well, I don't tell you. I don't want to have sex. So, of course I would cheat. I mean, I got another 30 years on this planet. Am I not going to have sex the rest of my life? What does the Bible say, Ted? What does the doctor say? And then what does the single man say out dating right now? Your thoughts? I just gave you a huge opening. And that's
number one, I've dated a lot of different girls over the last couple of years. And it's been interesting because the vast majority of them are basically, for lack of a better word, just crazy. And there's a reason they're single. There's a reason they're beautiful. There's a reason all of these things are happening. I can tell you story after story after story on the dating stuff, and it's just crazy. I mean, I've walked out of dates in as little as 30 seconds, 45 seconds, 1 minute, 4 minutes. I mean, I got up and left. I had this one girl from Ukraine. She's 5'11", blonde hair, blue eyes, beautiful girl, years old. And she's at dinner with me in Ukraine. And, you know, we're sitting there talking. She got more and more and more defensive. I said, look, I'm not doing anything. I'm just being neutral here. Go tell me about this. Tell me about that. And then finally she got really mad. And I said, well, look, I said, the reality is I'm asking you a question because your family is still in Ukraine. I want to know about the war. And I said, my grandfather was in Germany during World War II. He remembers the B-17 bombers flying over our little town and basically going to Hamburg and bombing it to oblivion and Bremerhaven, bombing it to oblivion. Yeah. And she goes, that never happened. That's not true. And I looked at her and I said, Bremerhaven didn't get bombed? Dusseldorf didn't get bombed? I said, well, I've got the videos of this from all the war correspondents. They were bombed into rubble. She goes, it never happened. She goes, let's drink. Well, I've got a common, I've got a policy. I don't buy alcohol on dates. I don't do it. Period, I don't. My mom had a problem with alcohol. I don't like alcohol. I stay away from it. And so I told her, I said, I'm not going to drink. She said, why won't you drink? I said, well, my mom had a problem with alcohol. Now, we're about 4 minutes into the date now. And finally, she goes, well, I want to drink. And I looked at her. I said, I want to leave. And she looked at me and said, this is a beautiful, beautiful woman. And I said to her, I said, here's the $5 for the bottle of water. I'm out. And I walked out. That was it.
Yeah, I've been there.
And she was there calling her Uber to come pick her up. But that was one day. Another one was 45 seconds. She's screaming, yelling, and cussing because her car got hit on the way to the day. Another one was – it's just – it never ends. Another one booked another date while we're waiting for a table, and I walked away.
And we're talking 20s and 30s, right? We're talking women in their 20s and 30s here.
20s, 30s, 50s. Yeah, and I've dated 60-year-olds. I've dated them all. And to me, it's like this. The Bible doesn't tell me how old I'm supposed to date or how young I'm supposed to date or how long I was supposed to wait after Sharon died. Now, it's been a couple of years now, and the reality is that, I don't care about the age. Now, it can get ridiculous because you're right. The young ones hit on you, and my response is always, why are you hitting on me? I don't want to go out with you. You're too young.
Okay, Ted. Well, that's what I want to talk about, okay?
Let's do it.
Because I read somewhere that the testosterone of a 13-year-old – look, I have daughters. I don't even want to tell you the stories, but I'm telling you, man, I see these guys are all very nice. It's like high five, and they're playing video games. And I'm happy. I'm happy as a father.
Yeah, okay.
Okay? But I'm telling you, when I'm 20 years old, these guys are 20 years old, and they're talking to each other and playing video games and texting. And, man, all I thought about is you know what. And these are my daughters, and these are nice guys. But I'm just saying, what the is going on, Ted? A 15-year-old of today has the testosterone of a 60-something-year-old in the 1940s. That's how bad it's gotten.
Well, it's not even worse than that, man. Over the age of 40 to 70, that age group, 50% of the men are impotent. They can't have an erection, period. They can't get it up. And a lot of them can't get it up using even Viagra or Cialis. They just can't get it up.
Yeah.
Their cardiovascular system is that bad. Their testosterone is that bad.
Well, I get testosterone. I get testosterone twice a year.
That's not
my testosterone's at 1,000. I do it twice a year. I don't know if you're hearing me or not.
I hear you must be doing pellets because you can't be doing injections twice. You have to do it
more. I'm doing pellets. Do you want to see it?
No, I'm good. I'm good, man. I don't need to see the pellets.
I'm going to show you.
Oh, come on, man.
You're a doctor. You're a doctor. A little one-cheek sneak's not going to hurt you. Doc. What happened to him? Did I lose him? Dr. Gronko, new male. I got about 10 friends doing it. Did he jump off? Did I lose him, Ralph, or will he come back?
I think it's a technical difficulty.
I think he just hung up on me. Well, I hope that's not the case. See if we can get him back. But Yeah, look at this. That's hilarious. That's hilarious. No, I get pellets put in twice a year, and you feel the energy, man. And most men of my age are at 400 testosterone. I don't even know what any of these numbers mean. I'm at 1,000. So, well. Oh, okay. There you are.
Did you just get censored? Was that a censored thing?
Yeah, we thought you hung up. I mean, I felt awful. No, I'm telling you, I'm pissing everybody off nowadays. I bought my blind buddy a cheese grater yesterday, and he said it was the most violent book he'd ever read. I mean, everything I do is wrong lately.
Okay, what? I don't take testosterone pills. My testosterone's still at 800. I'm good. And so, so here's the problem.
Wow.
When a woman is in basically has a baby in her, and she's basically, the baby's in utero, what ends up happening is that baby, if it's a Y chromosome, becomes a male, the clitoris turns to a penis, okay? Ovaries turn into, testicles. And if you don't have enough hormones in there for the testosterone, which are antagonistic to estrogen, that little boy never gets proper secondary sexual characteristics. Then you dump the fluoride into it, you dump the BPA, the mesfetal, and you dump all the female hormones in the food supply, which are all antagonistic to testosterone. That little boy, when he's 18 years old, has the testosterone of like a 9 or 10-year-old boy. It's ridiculous, and they never mature. They don't have any interest in women. None. Zero.
No, you see it. You see it, brother.
They can work out, and they don't even get any kind of response from the working out because they have no testosterone, and so they get more and more feminized. Now you have 30 at the age of 30. What is it? 70% of the men under the age of 30 don't even date. Some insane number like that. And the problem is when these women who are in their 30s and 40s call me up, they say we have nobody to date. The only guys that are available that are good still are the guys that are already married. We don't know what to do. So they call me up. I'm older than them. They don't really care at all. And I ask them, I say, why are you calling me up? And they say, we don't have anybody to date. We can either be single or date somebody that's got testosterone, date somebody that's an alpha male. And here's the other thing, too. You mentioned this earlier. When a man's over the age of 40 and his wife goes into menopause, or he's over the age of 50 and his wife goes into menopause, and she cuts him off from sex, it massively increases the risk of prostate cancer, period. And so it becomes a problem for a guy as far as if you don't use it. If you don't use it, you're going to lose it, and you get prostate cancer. And so with men, but Sharon never did that. Sharon was the greatest wife the world has ever known. I mean, she was the GOAT. She was the greatest of all time. My wife was. We were married for a long time. I love her. I still miss her. I wish I had her back. Problem is, she's not, because she's in heaven with Jesus right now. She's not coming back. So I had to go out and try to find somebody. Now, I have found somebody, but she's younger than me, but she's like 40 years old, and I'm okay with that. And I ask her again, why are you dating a guy who's older than you? She said the same thing. She goes, Ted, there are no other people to date that aren't weirdos. And she goes, the guys that are still single at, my age are either players or they're gay, period. That's it. Or they're married.
Ted, I want to move on. I want to tell you, I had a major rock star tell me about, I'm going to see U2, the Sphere, Bono, and this rock star. Well, anyway, the deal. And I heard about the deal. And does it involve Satan? What does it involve? And and then I'm reminded of a Catholic priest friend. So these are two separate stories. I'm going to try to blend them. And look at those guns on you, you show off. Anyway, so this guy, a famous person, came to the priest and said, look, I was taken in a room, and they said, you want to triple your, he froze up there, you want to triple your income? We want one of your kids. And he said, well, I'm not going to give you one of my kids. No, just spiritually. We want you to sign over one of your daughter's souls to Satan. And this person did it. And immediately the daughter exhibited satanic visions and possession. And it was really horrific. They got the kid exercised, and they moved, and they got away from all this. But The job offers and the money came in immediately. And I'm not saying you two made that deal, but I've had people say that are in the know, oh, they made the deal. And the deal doesn't necessarily mean you make it with Satan. I talked about being backstage with Rush, the band Rush, Neil Peart. I really, my opinion, really felt dark stuff there. Is that you breathing?
That was me breathing.
Oh my God!
That was me about to a deep breath back out.
Anyway, brother. So do you think that you don't get to be? I don't know. You don't get to be a big time politician unless you take the deal, right? I think they're all compromised.
Well, I know you like. I know. I know you know Trump. I know that. Okay, so I don't want to say a lot about Trump on this show. Now, if you turn
hold on, Ted, Doc. Let me tell you that I had a very powerful world leader, and people can figure it out. But I mean, the head of a country, tell me that Trump is dirty, he's bad, and I went, oh God, I don't want to hear this. And then he said, yeah, but Biden's 100% worse. So, you know, 100 times worse. So what do you do?
Well, here's what I tell people. Look, because number one, yeah, if Donald Trump gets back in office, as far as I'm concerned, we get to look at Melania. That's how I look at it. You know, he's got a beautiful wife. She's really, really nice.
Cities are going to burn. They're setting us up. That's why all these illegals are here. Well, they're going to burn America down if Trump gets elected.
I mean, these are soldiers. Donald Trump brought us Operation Warp Speed, which is extremely controversial at this point. Donald Trump basically closed the country down because of Operation Warp Speed. Donald Trump wanted to have the most pro-gay administration in the history of the White House. Donald Trump tried to push red flag gun laws to all 50 states through his daughter, working members of Congress. He did all of that.
Okay? Wait, Ted. Wow. Wow. That's hard. I don't care about gay guys.
Donald Trump put more CFR members into his administration and cabinet than any other president that I know of. And that's Council on Foreign Relations dedicated to world government. I mean, it goes on and on and on. Wilbur Ross brought Donald Trump out of bankruptcy when he worked literally for Rothschild Inc. back in the 80s, back in 88. All of this stuff. All of this, it's like they don't want us to have a choice. They want to give us who they want to put in front of us, and then they let us choose the lesser of two evils. That's what they do. That's what they always do.
It's about
creating friction.
Ted, so let's get back to something. Let's get back to something quickly. So I was brought up to believe, I don't care what side you're on, that abortion is wrong. It may be a necessary evil, but you know, no woman wants to go and get an abortion, right? They don't want it. Maybe they don't have the money. Whatever it is. But I thought we all agreed that abortion is horrible, and now it's like people love it, man. They love getting rid of the fetus, man. They just love it.
It's their sacrament. We talked about the beginning of the show. The world is run by the ancient Canaanite religions. The ancient Canaanite religions required human sacrifice of children. I mean, I was in Machu Picchu years ago, and they had the human sacrificial stone still in Machu Picchu. They killed children, and that's because the entities on the other side of the veil, these demons, fallen angels, whatever you want to call them, extraterrestrials, pick a name, they can't use the energy that comes out of the veil that we're in, this energy field from God, because they're separated from God. They have to have the energy of innocence through sacrifice. That's why we do 60 million abortions in the United States. That's why we have a million children go missing. Watch the movie with Jim Caviezel, you know, The Sound of Freedom. And they talk about all the human trafficking, all the rest of this. And so we've got a group of people in this country that are so satanic and so crazy and so corrupt, sacrifice children.
Ted,
it's true, Ted.
I'm in Machu Picchu, and they're talking about how great they were and how evil the Spanish were. And they're showing the holes where they played a game of basketball with heads. They would try to throw the heads in these holes. Did you see that in Machu Picchu?
And then I
could live in Peru, although I hear the government's horrible there. Anyway, so that Machu Picchu is Mexico, you know, and how great the Aztecs were. I mean, you know, they're killing babies and playing basketball with heads. And, you know, if the damn white man hadn't come, the white man, I guess, being the Spanish.
Do you remember what happened?
I love the people. I'm there in Peru. It's just hell on earth, man. If you touch a llama, you're dead. I mean, they're just that. No, that's the king's llama. Anyway, it goes on. It's so violent. It's so demonic. And those wonderful Incans, and then the evil Spanish people came. And a guy said, the white man will burn. The white man will burn. And I went, whoa, hang on, I'm just a tourist. And he goes, oh, no, you need suntan lotion. I don't want you to burn.
Woo!
Well, no, Quetzalcoatl, the winged serpent god, came to this group in South America.
Yeah, the winged serpent, the winged satanic devil. Yeah, those evil Spanish people with their Jesus. Yeah.
And they came in and they said, basically, if you but give your children and give you all of this ancient knowledge and how to do astrological calendars and read all the stuff of the stars, and they started worshiping Quetzalcoatl, which is just another name for Baal, Moloch, Asherah, whatever you want to
call it. Well, Baal is back big time, brother. Look at the Super Bowl. Look at the Emmys. Look at the Grammys and everything.
I won't watch any of that. I don't watch any of it, man.
Well, you're not missing much. You're missing two things, Jack and shit. Hey, did you hear that pizza I gave you, the best pizza on earth now? They're saying the best pizza on earth, I've been saying it for 30 years, is Pequod's Pizza. So congratulations to Pequod's Pizza. And now I just wait for the free pizzas. Just that doesn't happen. All right, Ted, you froze up there, and I don't know. Oh, okay, if we're doing a freezing contest, you win. Okay, wait, he's back. Border security, I'll tell you what I'm going to do.
Border security.
One sentence each. There's no border. Okay? It's rapid fire, Ted. Are you ready? What's the name of your show?
Let's do it.
What's the name of your show?
Ted and Austin Brower Show. Ted and Austin Brower Show.
Available wherever podcasts are. Who's this Hagman guy you keep bragging about?
Doug Hagman. I've been on the show many, many times. Doug Hagman's got another job. It's called the Hagman Broadcast. Hog Hagman Show. He's good, too.
Alpha males are disappearing. Do you think it's by design? It's environmental, yes. but they're making us weak. Who is it? The Chinese?
They want a bunch of pussies is what they want. Excuse my language, but that's what they want. They don't want men to stand up for themselves. They don't want men to defend their wives. If you're an alpha male, then look at me. If you're an alpha male and you got a wife and you got children, if you're not willing to die for them, you're not an alpha male, period.
I am.
Me too.
And that brings me back to my vision. Let me tell you my vision. Make sure I don't go bye-bye. Ralph, don't let me hang up without going bye-bye, telling that story. Going bye-bye like I'm talking to little kids. What? I got another guest? I thought we skipped the other guest. We're giving it to Ted. Did Putin tell the truth, do you think, to Tucker, Doc?
90%.
Why is it always good to think good things?
Because they've done a survey years ago and the people who become most successful in life are always good finders. They find the good in everybody.
Give another guest. Okay, we'll go to the other guest here in a second. Ted, you want to be on to the other guest? Or do you want
to
jump off?
I'll be on as long as you want me to, buddy.
Okay.
I'll do it.
Scalar waves.
I'll jump.
What happened?
I'll come back on again.
Yeah. Well, you're a big believer in prayer. Scalar waves. What are scalar waves? What happens when we pray?
When you pray, you change the fabric of space-time. Remember what the old plaque says. Zwei Lebensstutzen brechen nie, Gebet und Arbeit, heißen sie. Two principles of life that can never be broken, prayer and work. Prayer changes the fabric of space-time. You want to change your life? You want to change the world? You pray. That's what they don't want us to do. That's why they're scared.
How do I pray?
Always pray in the affirmative. Always pray as if it's already happened. Thank you, Father, that I'm always at the right place at the right time, every time, all the time. That's faith. That creates the energy field.
Magnesium important to take?
Magnesium every day. Magnesium CNA. So we have a product called Magnesium Brain Food available at healthpastors.com. It passes through the blood-brain barrier, chelates heavy metals out of the brain, keeps your cognitive abilities really, really high, helps prevent Alzheimer's disease and senile dementia and brain fog.
Zinc, good?
Zinc is critically important if you want to have sperm that's good and want to keep your sex drive up. You need about 50 milligrams of zinc every single day with 1,600 vitamins. I use a vitamin D every day. Not vitamin D, a vitamin E every single day. Right. And along with, we have another product called HGH Stimulate. It's like a natural Viagra with men. It's a great product, HGH Stimulate, and it doesn't cause you to go blind or deaf like Viagra can do.
I love all the warnings on these ads, right? You're going to have a boner, but you're going to be blind and down. Okay, all right, Doc. Dr. Ted Brower, thank you. Let's jump on to the other guest. I didn't realize we had anyone else. So let's do it. Bill, how are you? Good. I hope this wasn't too loose for you.
But interesting.
You were not interesting or it was interesting?
No, it's interesting.
Yeah. The hat. There's got to be a story behind that hat. Come on.
It's my daughter made it. It's a fabulous hat.
What's the story?
My daughter made it out of used denim. And the nice part about it is that it's warm in the winter. It's got, and my wife put Sherpa fur on the inside. So it is the most comfortable thing in the world.
Well, it looks very comfortable. Are you sure this is the way you want to look, though? I mean, there's a dozen people seeing us right now.
Let a dozen people enjoy themselves.
Okay.
I left my sunglasses in the car.
It's okay, Bill. I do this just because it's. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you got your hat. I got my glasses. We'll stick with the gimmicks. Tell me what's your take on the show? What do you want to comment on anything you've just heard? I didn't realize you were sitting there.
No, I was just fascinated. Let me just move here to get better in the camera.
Yeah, that's way better. That is better. Thank you.
Yeah, I was fascinated by the imminent presence of spirituality as opposed to the comings and goings of everyday lives. I mean, that came out in the conversation.
What does it mean? What does that mean, Bill?
It means that human beings have a choice. For most people, if you've ever seen the movie, it's probably the best line ever. It's a Robert De Niro movie called Once Upon a Time in America.
Yeah.
It's actually the fictionalized story of Joe Kennedy Sr.,
yes,
Meyer Lansky, and old man Edgar Bronfman. Okay, it's how they brought booze into New York during the Prohibition. It's how Meyer Lansky screwed Joseph Kennedy, and that's the whole other story. But in that story, when the Robert De Niro character has to flee, he flees New York City to go to Buffalo. And we don't see him until he's an old man. And he's brought back to New York because the synagogue, the congregation, is tearing up the graveyards and they need the ancestors of those who were buried there to reclaim the bodies for burial somewhere else. Okay, it's a tradition. So he comes back to New York. And they ask him, his old friend asks him, what was life like? You just disappeared. And he said, when you get up in the morning, take the bus, go to work, come home, go to bed, go up in the morning, take the bus, go to work, come home, life moves very quickly. And that is one way to look at your existence. And I found that fascinating.
Well,
this was very different. This was, you live in a world with the immediate presence of the good and evil. Now, the fascinating thing is when this person, Carlos Castaneda, did his dissertation.
I read all of it,
years and years ago.
Yeah.
And he spoke to this Yaqui Indian, Don Juan. The message that he got was that human beings live in a world in which they're oblivious to the immediate presence of allies, spiritual allies, and spiritual enemies. And he said that if you live your life, this is what the Yaqui Indian said, if you're able to live your life in that situation, it's a far richer life, more fulfilling, because you're aware of other realities. I'm not even get to Timothy Leary. Yeah.
Well, I've read all of Carlos's writings. I've done these trips in different jungles. I don't want to go into right now. Mm-hmm. I think some of these trips are very dangerous, to your soul, very dangerous to your life. I don't want to go there right now. Timothy Leary and I became very, very close. And spoke almost daily right up until the day he died. And
did you read his journal?
I have not. But let me just say one quick thing here, and that is he would have really loved, I don't, but he would have loved Kurzweil, and he would have loved Elon Musk and where we're headed with a singularity. I'm not a fan of hooking into the internet and having all the knowledge, but he felt that we were going to very shortly become one God brain, and that's what was coming.
If you want to really
that was all Leary was into.
If you want to be concerned about something, look at it this way.
Yeah.
What happened? Look at the Old Testament. What precipitated the flood? The end of the first of the civilization before us.
Well, man thought nothing but evil. Evil. Man had turned evil. All of our thoughts were evil. I'm seeing a lot of that around me right now.
What was the physical? The physical manifestation of that evil.
Was it idols?
The Tower of Babel.
Tower of Babylon, sure.
Right. Attempt to reach the creator.
And Babel is back.
All human knowledge.
Wow.
What do we have now?
Yeah. Well, yes. I've got it in my phone.
AI.
Yes. Yeah, baby. Yeah. Bill, why are you famous? What are you famous for? For people that don't know you, What's your thing?
I am not famous in the least bit. I am simply a college professor and a lawyer.
But
although we work on the same channel.
Tell us about the day after Roswell.
Well, years ago, I was working for a motion picture company in Los Angeles to take the rights that they'd acquired, the story rights, and translate them into book product for publishers. That was my job. I was a rights agent as a lawyer. The one person they brought was this person, Phil Corso, near the end of his life.
Yeah, yeah.
He'd had a very interesting life. We could spend the next month talking about it. But among the things he did, in addition to being, you know, the movie Exodus, the book Exodus, right, with Paul Newman, right? Yeah. Took the ship to, okay.
I think it's still playing.
Okay.
God, what a long movie. Person, yeah.
Phil Corso was the person who took a displaced persons camp north of Rome when he was the adjutant after World War II, after Mussolini was overthrown. And he got Meyer Lansky to send him a freighter.
Yeah.
Work with money from Lucky Luciano, had American soldiers guard everything, and they sailed it off to Palestine. And that's what got him kicked out of Rome. What happened was,
we got time limitations. Forgive me. And I got to you late. It's my fault, but go ahead, sir.
What happened was, where he was then posted, he saw the alien remains from the crash at Roswell. That's what he saw. And then when he worked at Army R&D, he had to take those remains to Senator Strom Thurmond, get a budget from him to reverse engineer those into American products.
Okay, Bill, are they the enemy?
Who? No.
You don't think they're the enemy?
No.
Go ahead. Yes.
The secret that nobody's going to tell you?
Come on.
We're the aliens.
I believe that.
We are the aliens. We're the ones.
From where?
I'll show you.
From where?
Here's how it happens. Enoch, if you ever heard of Enoch.
Of course.
His name means the inaugurated, the taken, the instructed.
I mean, Jesus and other people in the Bible are quoting Enoch. Okay, so yes, Enoch.
Yeah. Did you know that the very first edition of the King James Bible in 1619, the book of Enoch is included? Enoch's direct descendant. Get this. His direct descendant.
I didn't know.
Is Noah.
Is Noah, yes, of course.
Right. Right. Noah's direct descendant is Eber. Oh. Eber is the ancient word for Hebrew.
Okay. Eber's okay.
Direct descendant is Abraham. We're all okay. Descended so was from
Enoch,
Abraham.
You're saying that Enoch was an ancient astronaut? Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
And do we know from where? Do you have an idea of what planet?
I would say that throughout the galaxy, there is a species just like us. Maybe they don't look like us 100%, yeah, but they are like us.
And
Homo Galactica.
Homo Galactica. And the Freddie Mercury. No. And the yeah, that would have been a good name for his band. Okay. So wait a minute. So hold on here. So are these creatures, these grays, these bodies that were found and talked about in the day after Roswell, are they from another planet?
They're androids. They were androids. They had no lungs, no digestive systems, no alimentary systems at all. They were designed for space flight. And
yes,
they had around their heads ports.
Bill, what are you looking at, Bill? Can you look? Why are you looking off?
Here, how's this?
There, I want to see you. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay. Well, listen, brother.
They had ports. They had ports in their heads, and when they would control the ship, there were no controls like wheels or anything. They put things on their heads and they played these ships like instruments.
Bill, let me tell you, from Robert Fleischman from the band Journey, who wrote all those great songs, and to the hundreds in my career of people that I've spoken with. Communion. Who was Communion? What was that guy's name? Well, Whitley was on my show this past year. Whitley's fascinating. I mean, he's a character. Okay. But everybody says that there's no feelings there. That when those aliens are around, you're better around your wherever you are in a spaceship, wherever you are, you push them away and they just come right back. There's never any feeling. They are just lifeless. Now there's Mantis and there's others that show emotion, but the Greys that we know are just you push them over and they come right back to work.
They're workers. That's it. That's all they are.
And they don't defecate, they don't eat, they don't do anything, right? They're engineered to be travelers. They're but do we know the planet? Do we know the planet?
No. Although in the abduction of Betty and Barney Hill back in 1961, the planet was in the system of the twin star. There was a twin star, Zeta Reticula.
Right.
And the planet was in that.
Did we invite them here? Did we invite them here with our spiritualism?
They brought us here.
Why?
Because they're expanding through the galaxy. You know those comets?
So are we a good thing for this planet? Are we a good thing?
Well, you know the comets that passed through Oumuamua and Borisov? And they didn't act like comets. They were orbiting the wrong way. They were spinning the wrong way. They had water on their surface. You know what they were? Lawn sprinklers. They were fertilizing.
Yeah.
Planets that were habitable for life. That's how we got here.
Okay, so who's the book for? By the way, the minute you say book, I just want book. The minute you say book, Bill, I'm going to give you a little something from the media, okay? TV, okay. Radio, podcast, anything. The minute you say the word book, Americans turn you off. It's just unbelievable. So that, I shouldn't have even said that word, but I don't give a shit because we're having fun here. The Day After Roswell. Who should read the book? What's the point of the book?
You know, Bill? All the people that are testifying before Congress?
Yes, covered on News Nation.
You know where they got that in? Right?
From your book.
Yeah.
Bill. Bill, look, I've been covering this stuff since the early 80s, okay? And it was all horseshit. And now everybody's going, oh, I guess it was true. So much of what we covered, the people, it's bullshit. But now they believe it. Bill, okay, so why now? And why isn't CNN, Fox, and others covering it? I mean, and News Nation, I'm not pimping them. I do love the 60 Minutes correspondent from Australia that they have on. I can't think of his name, but I think that guy's a superstar. If Jesus appeared, wouldn't we talk about it? The fact that we have space alien bodies and spaceships, and it's being reported, and everybody's going, okay. I cannot believe this is not a huge story on every network all the time. So, Bill, why isn't everybody covering this?
Because
only News Nation.
It's not up to our political readers, our political leaders, to disclose this. Above them is another level.
And they want them to be quiet.
The people above them, okay?
Yeah.
There are.
Not the puppets.
I did a show, like you, I did a show on history called UFO Hunters. And on
with
that
Kevin
show,
Birnes?
What?
Were you with a producer named Kevin Birnes, Prometheus Entertainment?
Yeah.
One of my best buddies. So okay. I found a lot of those people, Bill, completely full of shit, by the way. Including Von Donegan. But okay. That's a whole other show.
Okay, so here we are. And we're looking for ancient alien sites and things like that.
Yeah.
There was a French report called the Cometa Report. It was from the French Defense Agency that used a lot of the Day After Roswell as their basis. One of their representatives came to me.
Order that book and read it again. Yes.
As a rule of thumb, if two entirely different sources tell you the same thing, that's validity.
It's true. Okay. Bill, do you know what's headed our way? Do you know what's coming our way?
Yes.
I'm asking you.
Yes.
What are we in for?
We
what are they getting us ready for?
As this moment, we are a dying species on a dying planet. That's what they're getting us ready for. They are us. We're their colony. There's no difference. You know who first told me that? Isaac Asimov.
Madam.
Isaac Asimov, back 50 years ago at Princeton, when he made an appearance there. And when I was doing UFO Hunters, a guy from the French Commando Report said the exact goddamn thing. And I said, hey, wait a minute. Asimov told me that. How do you know that?
Yeah.
And he said, because Asimov.
Dying planet, we're dying. I know that doctors, you know, they're not going to say it here, but I've had, you know, doctors tell me mankind doesn't have much time left. We are we're degrading.
You know this one doctor, Zachary Bush, he said that the soil on this planet by the end century.
Yeah, we eat a credit card a week with plastic.
Will not support.
Christian Moore said that on the show a couple of weeks ago. No, I've heard that, but I've also heard that we're just breaking down. And the fact is that Adam of the Bible would have been a Superman to us. The amount of sleep we need, as fragile as we are, the cancers that we're developing, I think some of it is by design. I mean, I think some of it's eugenics, but whatever. Something is going on with mankind. We are. Well, look at it, man. Look around. Look at your generation. Look at the old guys you remember from when you were a kid. And now look at what's passing for men in America now. Something's going on. And I blame those space aliens, Bill. And I blame you. Okay. I'm just kidding with you. All right. Guys, that was fascinating. Bill, I want to have you back on when I know you're there.
Okay.
You're a very handsome man. It's a shame. What's that?
We can talk about serial killers.
What are we going to say about serial killers? John Wayne Gacy.
I used to work for the Department of Justice to find them.
Well, John Wayne Gacy had a crush on me and used to call and try to have phone sex with me. And people say, well, did you have phone sex with him? No, but I did take his call. It was a big story here in Chicago. And he said some really, some frightening things that still frighten me.
That's
how many serial killers are there right now, Bill?
About 500.
Worldwide or in America?
In America.
Why are they usually white guys?
Because for black guys, you'd never know it. The serial killers we know are the serial killers who break through the media. There are a lot of other killers that never break through the media.
Who was the most sinister that you've studied or encountered?
Well, Ted Bundy was, but I'll tell you, Ted Bundy was, but Jeffrey Dahmer had a unique presence about him. So did Wayne Williams in Atlanta.
I remember all these people. Do you think that, do you believe Dahmer's conversion at the end?
No.
You don't think he found God?
No.
Was he building a satanic?
Yes. Dahmer was such a phenomenal sociopath.
Yeah.
Such an incredible sociopath that he actually built an altar of skulls.
Yeah,
that's why he was doing all the killing. You know when he did his first killing?
Chicago.
On the night of his prom.
Oh, yeah.
You know the story? His parents had this massive fight and walked out. Dahmer gets in a car, drives around, picks up a hitchhiker, brings him back, sleeps with him, winds up killing him and burning his body.
Broke the bones up, left him out in the field behind the house. But
he was driving around with the body in his car when the cops stopped him for driving drunk.
Yeah, how about the kid that broke free and the cops gave him back, the little Filipino?
That's right.
The
Cambodian kid.
Cambodian, okay. Was it just a sick, twisted piece of art, or did he believe he was summoning something?
Who, Dahmer?
Yeah.
He had no higher aspiration except not to be alone. That's why he ate his victims.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I have to tell you, when the Dahmer case broke, I was a young man and I would smoke marijuana And I had a big lava lamp. Oh, I know. I had a big lava lamp next to my bed in Suicide Falls, Missouri. And I would look into the lava lamp and I would imagine I was on the surface of Mars or on another planet. And it would just bubble and I would just be there eye level as I went off to sleep. And then I heard Dahmer say that's what he used to do and that he would look into his lava lamp and would get messages from Satan. And I got rid of my lava lamp. And I stopped smoking and looking into my lava lamp. And
no more lava lamps.
No more lava lamp, Bill. Well, you dropped the big one on us right as I was ready to say goodbye. Is there something you want to tell us about? Can you give us one bump, bump, bah, show ender with your space alien writing and research?
Very soon.
Yes.
As the planet warms up and floods and as crops die, you will see disclosure. Maybe not your children, but certainly your grandchildren.
I've talked to lots of sailors that I like seamen. No, I've talked to lots of sailors that talk about seeing underwater football field size things.
Exactly. Florida Gulf.
Are there bases under the water?
Yes, between Florida and Cuba and between the Catalina Island and San Pedro, California.
A lot of spottings. Why?
Off of Point Doom in Malibu.
But are they here to watch us, Bill? I mean, what's their point? Why are they here? They live here.
They're in business.
Are we putting on a show? Are we their TV show?
Yes. We're the AI of the aliens.
All right. As my mom used to say, not you, Bill, to me. She used to say, shut up, and I'm going to shut up now. So, all right. Good night, everybody. That was a great show.
Everybody.
What fun. I think it's the longest one we've ever done. That was great.